So the basis for the collaboration was a discovery that both David and I independently do research on how cognitive agents come to learn to autonomously represent the world and reason about it. David does work more on computers and robots, and I do work on humans. So the question is, could we take some of David's principles and then apply them to extend human models of cognition? And so that's what we're going to talk about today. The one we settled on was perception action learning. So David's going to talk about what perception action learning is and the fundamental questions that addresses. But I'll talk about how we try to implement that in a model of human cognition to see what we can find.
Thanks, Adrian. So I'd like to introduce the notion of perception action learning via a very simple thought experiment. Yeah. No, nothing doing. Got it. So I'd like to introduce the notion of perception action learning by way of a philosophical thought experiment, if you like. So the question is, if you were a human brain in a vat, you'd never known anything else other than this vat, how would you perceive the world if your only connection to the world was via a video camera, past all the usual scenes of everyday life? Would that brain perceive the world in exactly the same way that we would? And I would argue that it wouldn't. I mean, there is no incentive, for instance, for it to form a concept of objects because it's not interacting with the world. The world for it might as well just be a mass of colored pixels or retinal imprints. Right, is it gonna work? I'll do this the old-fashioned way. That's fine, I'll fall back on that. So, it's clear that there is a very fundamental link between perceptions and actions. And this is something that we found to be particularly useful in cognitive robotics, where the traditional model is that you form a model of the world and then you plan actions within it. But there's a big problem with that, at least with the traditional approach. The action space of a robot, its motor possibilities, are typically very much smaller than the space of perceptual possibilities, and this leads to problems like symbol grounding, a lot of redundancy. So perception action learning proposes to be an answer to this, and it works from the motto that actions precede perceptions, that actions are in some way more fundamental than perceptions. So the idea, in formal terms, or at least the way I formalized it, is that there is some sort of sub-manifold within the space of possible motor actions that corresponds to the space of possible affordances, the things that the agent thinks that it can do in the world. And there's a one-to-one mapping between that action space and perceptual transitions. In other words, the agent only needs to represent the things that it thinks it can meaningfully change. So this actually turns out to eliminate masses of redundancy. I mean, for instance, if you start with just a video input, you have an enormous space of possibilities. But as soon as you notice there are certain regularities in that world, certain invariances, you notice that certain objects or certain entities can undergo displacement and retain their appearance, you can begin to formulate the concept of objects so that you see the world in terms of the things you can that keep their identity under translation. And that is a very, very much more compact representation of the space. So we can actually build those more compact representations on top of each other. For instance, if you built the concept of object and with its corresponding perceptual space, so you have the degree, the actions that you can associate with objects, it correlates with the perception of objects. But say you might, after experimentation with objects, begin to discover that, say, some objects are containers that you can put one object in type of another, inside of another. So basically, there is a subsumption hierarchy of possibilities. And for every higher level perception, there is a corresponding set of actions. So this was the theory that I handed over to Adrian. See if I have any luck with that.
It's easy when you know how. So David's work is very interesting and shows that this perception, action, and learning is an effective way for a cognitive agent to learn to represent the world. But for a psychologist, this raises a couple of questions. It might be effective for a robot, but is this cognitively plausible? Could a human, given our limitations of memory and attention and so on, perform the calculations that are required to learn in this kind of a way? So the way to test that out was to try and do it, to take a model of cognition that has the constraints of human cognition built into it, and see if it can, when we apply the perception, action, learning principles to it, see if it will learn and to think about the world as David describes. So what we've done is taken David's principles and used them to extend an existing cognitive architecture. The architecture we've chosen is ACTAR, which is a widely used general cognitive architecture, and it's got one particularly nice feature. So the historic and future trend of psychology is towards specialisation. People look at smaller and smaller pieces of cognition, which is necessary because of the complexity of it. But one of the interesting features about ACTAR is it kind of brings all those things together. When you just look at the small pieces, you do wonder how we all fit together into a bigger picture. So what ACTAR does is takes the models from each of these different areas of cognition, takes models of vision, models of memory, models of motor control, and link them all together. So you can now have a running model of the whole thing, which if you're going to look at perception action is linkages, it's important to have both models of perception and bits of action working together. And then these are mapped onto underlying brain areas, which give a nice kind of biological constraints to the way that it works. So we try to build a model of perception action within this general human cognitive architecture. And to do this, we just have to get ACTAR to follow the general principles of perception action, which are to, first of all, just random exploratory motor movements in the world, just grabbing things just to see what happens. It then observes what occurs, what are the consequences of those actions, and then develops some categories based on what invariant features those are. So if every time it sees a teacup, it is blue, then it starts forming a category of blue teacups. And then re-represents the world based on these higher order categories and starts exploring the world in terms of these higher order categories, which creates more examples and a more abstract categories are formed, and you move up the subsumption hierarchy to a more abstract understanding of the world. So we just had to get ACTAR to try and follow these steps. So first of all, I'll just try and show you an illustration. This is a not implausible way about how babies learn about the world. So this is a baby, and I'll see if I can get him to move around. So what babies do is they do this. They just have random exploratory movements. They just thrash their arms around a bit and bash things. And occasionally they bash something and something happens. So it hits the yellow lever and something spins. And then the consequences of actions are interesting. It stares at that for a bit more, tries to explore it and bash, and then it goes back to the random bashing. So over many months, babies generate many examples of what they do when they do things in the world. And these are all form the raw material of trying to understand what is going on. So we wanted to make a model that did that, that just bashed around the world, eventually figured out what was going on without actually telling it in advance. So this is I'll just show you the model that we did so you can see it running. So the task we had is a shape sorter task, which David has used before. So same as a child's toy, what the model had to do was pick up the pieces and put them in the holes. So we had to move around the different colored circles, the yellow and blue and so on, and then place them in holes. We don't tell it to you that in advance, it just finds out by exploring. I'll just show you it doing this. So it is, okay, so you'll see it moving around. The little red circle is its visual attention, which moves around the screen as it sees different objects and pulls them around. And that's it, just exploring the space, putting things around, and just seeing what the consequences of its actions are, remembering what those consequences are, and then slowly building up what these categories might be. At the bottom of various buffers, you can see what it is. The one in the middle is a visual buffer, so that tells you what information it is perceiving at that particular point in time. So it could be looking at the features of a black circle in the middle of a screen. And so those are all the many examples of different bits of the brain and what information it is processing at any point in time. So here's our model output, which is just a buffer trace. In the list are all the different bits of the brain and the different tasks they have, vision, motor control, attention, and so on. And you can see in the bars the different times that they're active. So these things all occur in parallel and are interleaved as the task progresses. At the bottom we have a picture of the brain. Each of these different areas are mapped onto different brain areas, and you can see as the task progresses, these different bit areas change colour, which is the model prediction about the bold response in these different areas, which is an index of brain activity. So we've got nice, again, these nice kind of biological constraints to the plausibility, which add to the plausibility of the model. So the project isn't quite over yet. We've got to implement some more advanced perception action learning into it to do some more interesting things with our shape sorter task. And then we want to expand it future in two different directions. One is downwards to look at more sophisticated visual inputs with depth and three dimensions and texture to the images and so on. And also it's interesting to move upwards. So we just had one agent interacting with the task there. We could easily have two. And when they categorize something, they might think up a label for it. The other agent might learn this. And we've got the basis of forming a shared functional language of what they're doing. And other more complex social behaviors can emerge from these interactions. So overall, this will lead us to a general architecture, which can deal with many complex things, all of which remain grounded in interactions of the world, but can build up more sophisticated and abstract ways of thinking about it. I've really overrun on time, so I apologize for that. Thank you.